Sam, so the Church of Scientology is obviously a very well-known, very secretive religion, but recently a lot of key people have started to leave the church and talk really for the first time about life inside. Take a look. The Church of Scientology is never far from the headlines, whether it's the mystique created by its mega-famous celebrity followers or the secrecy surrounding its inner workings. There's a strong curiosity about what really happens behind these doors. Founded in 1954 by L. Ron Hubbard, a science fiction author and creator of Dianetics, a self-improvement system, today it's led by David Miscavige, claims to oversee millions of members worldwide. But his niece, Jenna Miscavige Hill, is not one of them. The 29-year-old has recently left the church and has written a new tell-all book where she describes growing up as a Scientologist and what she calls a harrowing escape from the church. Jenna Miscavige Hill is here joining us now. Thanks very much for being with us. So you were really born into the Church of Scientology. Your parents were Scientologists.
Right, that's right, yes.
And so, I mean, you grew up your entire life, this was really all you knew.
Yes.
What was it like growing up in the church?
I mean, it was abusive, it was confusing, but at the same time, it was all that I knew, you know, so it was normal to me.
When you say it's abusive, what do you mean?
I mean, you know, from when I was 4 years old till I was 12 years old, we were only allowed to see our parents once a week.
Really?
Yeah, even
almost
less.
Almost in heart, so young, not being able to be with your parents, I can't imagine.
Yeah, I mean, but that's how it was for all of us. And so I sort of thought that, you know, it was just me and I was the weird one for wanting to see them more. And
what was the thinking on not seeing your parents? Why would they not let you see your parents?
I mean, because they were working. They were members of the Sea Organization, which is the most dedicated Scientologist. It's like the clergy, so to speak. And
the Sea Organization is a group within the church that basically kind of manages and runs the church. People who join the church, like, are not necessarily part of Sea Org. Sea Org are people who, I mean, live, eat, breathe the church, right?
Exactly, yeah. They sign billion-year contracts and they live communally.
Billion-year contract?
Yes.
So did you join the Sea Organization?
Yes, I did. Yeah.
How old were you?
I was 12.
12?
Yeah.
So when you were 12 years old, you signed a billion-year contract.
Well, I actually originally signed it when I was 7 because we were considered cadets who were basically being groomed to become Sea Org members. And then when I was 12, I was told, you are a Sea Org member now. And
in the book, you write about kind of your schooling or lack of and the amount that you were actually kind of, it seems like you were working from what you said.
Yes, absolutely. We worked, like, did physical labor for 4 hours a day.
What kind of physical labor? Like,
trench digging for irrigation, like digging holes to plant trees in.
How old were you?
It was between when I was 6 until I was 12.
Wow.
So is that legal?
I don't know how they get away with it, but
what made you decide to leave?
It was just a whole lifetime of all sorts of abuses, physical, mental, controlling, being separated from my family, that, you know, eventually, at some point, I became somewhat aware of the outside world. Me and my husband actually lived in Australia for a year.
You met your husband. He was also a member of the church.
Yes, yes. And we were on a church mission in Australia for a year, and we were sort of away from everything that I had been around my whole life. And I started to see how, like, you know, that this, you know, the outside world is completely different. Yeah, and so going back, it was really hard to ignore some of the things that were just crazy.
Did you tell your parents? Did you talk to them saying that you wanted to leave? Or
when I was leaving, they were actually out of the church already, and they actually helped me to leave.
So they actually left before you?
Yes.
When they left, why did you stay in?
Yeah. You know, because, I mean, like I said, when I was 6 till I was 12, I only saw them once a week. Well, from when I was 12 till I was 18, I only saw my mom twice.
From 12 to 18, you only saw your mom twice?
Yeah, two times.
Being a mother, I can't imagine that.
Yeah.
I can't imagine that.
I know, me neither.
Yeah, I knew that. Yeah, now.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, and my dad only, like, 4 times. And several, like, 2 of those times were less than an hour. And so by the time that they left, I hadn't been around them, you know, and I had sort of created my friends there and everything I knew, and the idea of leaving was scary to me.
Yeah.
And So I stay.
We're going to take a, you know, obviously a lot of people know a lot of celebrities are a member of this church. Why does the church attract so many celebrities, you think?
I mean, I think that a lot of the celebrities that are there were actually born into it, like, you know, Lisa Marie Presley or Erica Christensen and or Beck, those type of people. But I mean, I think that the church actually targets celebrities because they see that as a way to get Scientology out there and get more people in.
Do you think the celebrities know kind of what goes on inside the C organization? Because the C organization, which again is that inner management group, I mean, you guys are like isolated out in a ranch area. I mean, you have a different compound.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I think that, you know, that type of thing is sort of kept away from the celebrities to a degree. I mean, they never run across child laborers or things like that. But I mean, the information's out there. So I think if they don't know about it, it's like a sort of willful ignorance. And I think that any celebrity who lends their name to such an organization has the responsibility to know what they're supporting.
I want to read you a statement that the church has made. And the church has also put out pictures of where you went to school. And they said, this is what it's really like, that it's not, you know, kids working, that the pictures that we're going to show, you know, it looks, everybody looks pretty happy. And the statement they make, they say, the church will not discuss private matters involving Ms. Hill, nor any of the efforts to exploit Mr. Miscavige's name. That's the leader of the church. We note the recollections in Ms. Hill's book about her schooling are dramatically at odds with the recollection of 30 of her classmates. Revisionist histories are typical of apostate behavior, and tabloid tales should always be taken with enormous grain of salt. We'll put the rest of the statement on our website at andersoncooper.com. But so they consider anybody who leaves the church an apostate or a suppressive person. What is a, can you explain what a suppressive person is?
A suppressive person is somebody who is considered evil, basically. And in Scientology, it's like a high crime, like a crime of the highest order to speak out against the church. And so when you get declared a suppressive person, you cannot speak to any Scientologists.
So your friends who are still in the church and stuff, who you grew up with, spent your life with,
you can't talk to them.
You, you have no contact with them. Mm-hmm. That's got to be hard.
Yeah.
When you see the pictures that the church is putting out saying, you know, this is where you grew up, this is what it was really like. Mm-hmm. And again, they look pretty, you know, idyllic pictures. That's, I guess, the school you went to. What do you, or is this how you remember it?
I mean, like the pictures, those rock walls, we hauled all those rocks. I mean, that's a specific, that's a art studio that we were allowed to go there like the day it opened, but it was really used as like isolation for children who are misbehaving. So we maybe visited that wonderful looking studio like a couple times a year. I mean, they have pictures of ballet lessons. We never did dancing lessons there. We did have PE, but the rock walls you see there, we built all those. The railroad ties that are bordering the property, we hauled all of those there.
As children?
Yes, yes. Even the gravel that you see around the cactus, we planted the cactus. You know, we laid the tarp underneath the gravel. We hauled the gravel from piles and wheelbarrows and dumped it there and raked it out. So it's just so misleading that they put it as such a great environment. The ranch didn't look like that when I got there, and it does look like that because of child labor.
When, now, what's your life like?
I mean, I'm married. I have two kids and a dog. I live in,
Look at your beautiful family.
When you look back on it, I mean, what do you make of it? I mean, when, looking back on it all.
I mean, it's crazy. I mean, obviously leaving was like the best thing I ever did. I would never have my children if I stayed there, which obviously are like the center of my whole world now. And, but I mean, it's crazy, you know, it's hard to get over some of the things that happened there, but also, you know, if I hadn't gone through that, I wouldn't be where I am now.
Do you have a closer relationship with your parents now?
Yeah, I do. I mean, you know, I had questions like, you know, how did this happen and that sort of thing. But I mean, I know more than anyone that they were brainwashed.
Yeah.
I was too when I was there. And I mean, we have a good relationship now. They're great grandparents to my kids, which is all I could ask for.
Well, I wish you the best. Thank you so much for being with
us. Thank you so much.
Everyone in the audience is going to go home with a copy of Jenna's book, Beyond Belief, My Secret Life Inside Scientology, and My Harrowing Escape. So everybody in the audience is going to go home with a copy of the book.